तो सेशन दैट इज अनदर सेशन ऑफ एंगेजमेंट एंड वील बेसिकली टॉक अबाउट मैक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स अगेन. तो दिस इज द थर्ड पार्ट आई थिंक ऑफ मैक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स. बिफोर वी स्टार्ट लेट मी टेल यू अबाउट व्हाट वी ट्रांसपायर्ड इन द लास्ट टू सेशंस. बेसिकली वी स्टार्टेड विथ द डिफरेंस बिटवीन माइक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स एंड मैक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स. आई एक्सप्लेन हाउ देयर इज ए कॉम्प्लीमेंट्री रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन माइक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स एंड मैक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स. देन वी वेंट ऑन टू डिस्कस अबाउट द डिटर्मिनेशन ऑफ नेशनल इनकम, हाउ वी डिसाइड डिटर्मिन नेशनल इनकम, हाउ वी मेजर नेशनल इनकम इन टर्म्स ऑफ द मेथड्स एंड द कंसेप्ट्स लाइक जी डी पी, जी एन पी, पर कैपिटल इनकम, डिस्पोजेबल इनकम एंड ऑल द कंसेप्ट एसोसिएटेड विथ योर नेशनल इनकम अकाउंटिंग. देन इन द सेकेंड पार्ट वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट मैक्रो इकोनॉमिक थ्योरीज एंड इवोल्यूशन ऑफ मैक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स ओवर द ईयर्स. वी स्टार्टेड विद द क्लासिकल थ्योरी, देन वी ऑल्सो डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द केन्सियन थ्योरी. एंड व्हाइल डूइंग द क्लासिकल एंड केन्सियन थ्योरीज आई टॉक्ड अबाउट द क्लासिकल कंसेप्ट ऑफ क्लासिकल डाइकोटोमी, हाउ वेयर 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 देयर इज ए डी कंपार्ट देयर इज ए कंपार्टमेंटलाइजेशन बिटवीन द रियल सेक्टर एंड द मॉनिटरी सेक्टर. Then while discussing about the Keynes theory, there I told you about the simple Keynesian theory of income determination. And I made a distinction between the classical theory and the Keynesian theory. In today's lecture, we are basically talking about the post-Keynesian theory, where we talk about what happened to macroeconomic theories and the evolution of macroeconomic theories after Keynes. To understand that, we'll have to again start from the classical theory, then we introduce Keynes theory, then we'll move to the integration of the two. So today's lecture is on, you might have seen the book, it is about equilibrium in the goods market and equilibrium in the money market. Now, as I told you, we started the classical theory, just to remind you, because without this we cannot move forward. I told you while teaching the classical theory that in the classical theory, two to three things are very important to understand. The first is that there is full employment equilibrium. The first thing the classical people have assumed is that full employment equilibrium is given. I already told you this is just to keep the macroeconomics out of the picture because they were basically microeconomics. They were dealing with microeconomic issues. The classical people kept macroeconomics outside the purview of the study. So therefore, they took the whole, the macro as given. As I've already told you, the entire body is given. We just talk about the finger. So what they said the total output of the economy is given. So while doing this, I told you that the aggregate supply curve in the classical theory is given as a vertical straight line, indicating that if this is my output and this is the price axis, we know from the demand analysis also. So this is my AD and AS. That is aggregate demand, aggregate supply in the macroeconomic sense, and this is the price level we take in macroeconomic sense. There I told you that since the macroeconomic variable of complete output, total output, is a given, it is a constant, not a variable. The entire aggregate output or the total production is given in the classical scheme. The aggregate supply curve is a vertical straight line at a particular place. This is called the full employment equilibrium. Or you can also write this as YF, if Y represents aggregate demand or aggregate income, total income, then when all the resources are fully employed, then the maximum possible potential output in the economy is to be YF, full employment output. Given this, the output is or the income level is out of the purview of the analysis. Now we are not discussing or not interested to determine output because it is already determined, it is already given. Now, what is not decided in the classical theory? The price level. See, this axis is open now. So, in the classical theory, as I told you in the last class, repeatedly I told you in the last class, that in the classical theory, output is given or income level is given. What is to be decided is the price level. And we decide the price level. All the classical people have decided the price level in terms of the aggregate demand curve. If we draw the aggregate demand curve like this, then this aggregate demand is equal to aggregate supply, and this will decide the equilibrium price level. Suppose I write PE. And again, I told you in the last class that this aggregate demand is determined on the basis of the quantity theory of money. That's why we call the classical theory the supply side theory. They say that it is the supply of money which determines the price level, MV equal to PT. So more the money supply, more the price level. Less the money supply, lower is the price level. So there is a direct and proportionate relationship between money supply and price level. Therefore, the aggregate demand, it depends on the quantity of money. And on the basis of that, we decide the price level. Now, the second question is, when we are talking about this, the price level and the full employment equilibrium, if we represent this particular issue in terms of the Keynes theory, Keynes took a different view. I've already explained in the last class, just to introduce, remind you. Keynes took the aggregate supply curve like this. This is the aggregate supply curve. This is the full employment equilibrium. This is the aggregate supply curve. Keynes says that the aggregate supply curve is a horizontal straight line, not a vertical straight line. It is a horizontal straight line where it is stationed at the price level. That means the price level in the economy is given. We know the price level. At this price level, the output at which the economy is going to satisfy itself, or the maximum output that the economy is producing, is less than the potential full employment output. The full employment output, as we know, in terms of the classical theory, is an unattainable output by any economy, any level of economy. So it is not, full employment is not a situation, not a solution, which can be attained by the economy. That means each economy, whether developed or underdeveloped or developing, they have to contend with an output which is less than the full employment output. Now the question is, this underemployment equilibrium, this is called the underemployment equilibrium, this less output or the level of output at which the economy has to satisfy itself with is to be decided. We don't know where this economy is having the level of output. Therefore, price is decided here, price is known here. What is to be decided? The aggregate output. So if they draw the aggregate demand curve, then we can decide the equilibrium level of output. This is your AD equal to AS. Now this is the equilibrium level of output, or we can say the output, actual output, or YA we can write. This is the actual output. So in the classical theory, price is to be decided. In the Keynes theory, output is to be decided. Now, this we have already discussed in the last class. We'll move away from this now. Now the question is, this classical theory of full employment equilibrium, as I said, is based on the classical concept of the classical dichotomy. Diamonds too, I already discussed in the last class. So there is two separate division or decomposition of the economy into real sector and the monetary sector. The real sector is different from the monetary sector. That means whatever you decide in the real sector, if I am deciding the output level in the real sector, once the output level is given, then we are not deciding anything. So real output is not to be decided. Then money depends on what? The quantity theory of money by the classical. That means they say that the money supply depends on, the money supply is given fixed, and the demand for money depends on, again, your quantity theory of money. Now, having said this, we move forward to the Keynes theory. How Keynes looked at the dichotomy? See, in the Keynesian theory, we have to see the real sector and the monetary sector in two different ways. We'll see whether the real sector and the monetary sector are different as the classical dichotomy has postulated, or is there any linkage between the real sector and monetary sector? If the two sectors are interrelated, then how to derive the equilibrium? Because up to Keynes, like the classicals, up to Keynes, even Keynes also determined the equilibrium separately. Although he has not talked about classical dichotomy, he has not supported classical dichotomy, but he has determined the equilibrium separately. This is the point which every student must understand, that the classical dichotomy is basically to make a clear-cut distinction between the real sector and the monetary sector. Once we come up to the Keynes part in the 1936, in that case, Keynes also developed his theory on the basis of the line of real sector equilibrium and monetary sector equilibrium. in the two different way. Although he is not a propounder of or a supporter of the classical dichotomy, what he has shown that in the simple Keynesian model, we can make a distinction between the real sector equilibrium and the monetary sector equilibrium. Once you understand the real sector and the monetary sector equilibrium separately, then only we can make a link between the two. So the post-Keynesians or the Keynesians, the followers of Keynes, they came up with an advanced version of the interlinkages between the real sector and monetary sector. They say that, okay, the real sector equilibrium developed by Keynes is having a close relationship with the monetary sector equilibrium given by Keynes. That means we cannot compartmentalize between real sector equilibrium and monetary sector equilibrium. We have to associate or interlink both once you recognize the importance of the macroeconomic equilibrium. So since Keynes championed the need for macroeconomic equilibrium, need for macroeconomic analysis, he sought interlinkages. And the people, the economists who followed Keynes, they established the interlinkage between these two. Therefore, what we'll do, we follow Keynes first, and first derive the goods market equilibrium, goods market means real sector. We first see the goods market equilibrium. Then we also talk about the money market equilibrium. Then following the Keynesians, what we'll do, we'll see the interlinkage between these two, because macroeconomics means if I'm talking about my whole body, then as I said in the last class, all the parts, all the systems and all the subsystems and processes of my whole body are interconnected. We cannot study one part of the body by isolating the other parts or in isolation. Therefore, each part has to be seen in terms of a system approach, in terms of its association and its interconnection with the other parts of the whole system or structure. Therefore, if we are studying the macroeconomics in true sense, then we cannot keep the real sector aloof from the monetary sector, nor do we have the justification to talk about the monetary sector completely in isolation of the real sector. Both the goods sector and the monetary sector has to be seen as a whole, as a bigger whole, as a part of the entire macroeconomic theory. Therefore, today's lecture will be basically on this. Now see how Keynes has done this. The Keynes goods market equilibrium, first we move to the real sector, there is goods market equilibrium. Now, the goods market equilibrium, the Keynesian theory, is based on, there is something called the fundamental psychological law of consumption. The fundamental psychological, this is the basic Keynes theory, simple Keynes theory, fundamental psychological law of consumption. I think you might have studied this, but I don't know, but I will teach you no issue. Fundamental psychological law of consumption, this is a law. Law means which has already been applied, which has already been studied empirically. So the fundamental psychological law, that means fundamentally, at the basic level, at the elementary level, consumption follows a particular direction. Consumption follows a particular path. And that path is basically psychological in nature. That's what is called the fundamental psychological law. That means, psychologically, if we say, even without going into the deeper into the analysis, we can say that consumption is a function of income level. The fundamental psychological law of consumption in the basic Keynesian model says that consumption is a function of income level. That means, how much we consume depends on how much money do you have, how much money we have. Now, this is the relationship between consumption and income. Other factors remaining constant, ceteris paribus, you must that keep in mind. Because consumption also depends on a lot more other factors, like your cultural factor, institutional factors, your customary factors, rate of interest, climatic conditions, cultural setup, a lot of factors are there. But taking other factors as constant, Keynes says that consumption is a function of income level. Now, this relationship between consumption and income is positive. It is a direct relationship, but not a proportional relationship. He says that as income increases, consumption also increases, but not in the same proportion. And it's clear also, it is known to everyone also. if a person is having low, very low income, if a person is having very low income or subsistence level of income, just sufficient for consumption, then he will spend maybe 99% or 100% of his income on consumption. But as income increases, you can make a comparison between a person having a daily income of rupees 100 and another person, a very super rich person, having a daily income of rupees maybe 10 crores. Now, if you say that the person who is earning 100 rupees a day is spending, suppose, 90% of his income, this person A is earning rupees 100 in a month. So how much he is consuming? 90%, money? 90 rupees. Out of 100 rupees that he is earning, very, 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 very low status person, he is spending 90 rupees on consumption. So we can say that 90% income is being consumed. 90% income is used for consumption. This is a very high percentage. Now the person B is there whose daily income is suppose 10 crores. 10 crores. If we apply the same logic and say that 90% of the total income will be spent on consumption, then it comes to 9 crores. It's not possible. Nobody in the world will spend 9 crores per day at whatever level of luxury or achievement you aspire to. No way. Therefore, as income increases, at most this man can spend 10 lakhs or 20 lakhs maybe per day. That is also very huge sum. So 10 lakhs, 20 lakhs, and this comes to less than maybe 10%, less than 10%, maybe 2%, 3%, 4%. That means as income increases, you can see, observe from this, as income increases, consumption no doubt increases. Because when a person gets more and more richer, he will try to spend more and more on consumption. But after a point is reached, the relationship between income and consumption is although direct, it is although positive, but the proportion declines. The proportion declines. Less and less, less amount of the increased income is spent on consumption now. This is called the fundamental psychological law of consumption. And through that, what Keynes has done, he has derived the consumption function. So consumption function. How to derive the consumption function? Now, if I take my income here, why I am income taking on the x-axis, and this is my consumption, C. Now the consumption function is like this. This is C, is a function of Y. Now where the consumption function is like this, this is upward sloping indicating what? Positive relationship between income and consumption. More the income, more the consumption. But this is not originating, this is not starting from the origin, because it is not a proportional relation. It is not a 90 degree line, it's 45 degree line. This is not a 45 degree line. This line starts from the Y-axis. Now, why this much of consumption is having no relationship with income? That means this much of consumption is possible. Suppose this is 10% I take. This 10% consumption is happening even at zero income. You can see this. The income is zero at this point, because this is my income axis. So even at zero income, we are getting a consumption of this much. And that is possible. Even if at zero income, people consume to survive, to sustain. Therefore, consumption is possible and also positive, even at zero level of income. So therefore, this part of consumption, this 10% consumption, is independent of income or autonomous of the income. It is not depending on the income level. Therefore, this is called the autonomous consumption. This is called the autonomous consumption, autonomous or independent consumption, independent of income. Now, this autonomous consumption, we can also take it as CA. A means autonomous, autonomous consumption. So, this total income Y, whatever total income I have, this total income Y is a combination of this much of income which is independent of consumption, this much of consumption which is independent of income, not associated with income, plus the rest part of consumption, which is a function of income. From this point onward, higher the income, this is the consumption. Or more the income, in consumption increases. Further increase in income, consumption increases. But see the relationship between the increase in income and increase in consumption. It decreases. It decreases. Therefore, this is not a 45 degree guideline, a 45 degree line. So that means there is a disproportionate relationship, increase in income and consumption with every increase in income. So the consumption function is upper and like this. So this further change in consumption depends on C into Y. This small c indicates marginal propensity to consume, MPC. We'll see what is MPC and APC. There are two concepts. One is called APC, average propensity to consume, and one is called marginal propensity to consume. Now, average is, you know, that delta, sorry, total consumption by total income C by Y. That means whatever total consumption you have with respect to this point and this income, this by this, that means this line. If we draw perpendiculars from the origin to any point on this line, then this will show you APC, average propensity to consume. That means this by this, this by this. So this line will tell you the APC, C by Y. And it keeps on falling, because as income increases, the proportion of consumption falls. But MPC is, it is the change in consumption due to change in income. That is the slope of the consumption function, this slope of the consumption function. That means how much change in consumption is possible due to a given increase in income or given change in income. So change in consumption due to change in income will show you the marginal propensity to consume, MPC. Now, this small c is MPC. That means what proportion of change in income you have devoted for consumption. So this is the fixed part of consumption plus that proportion of consumption, that proportion of income you are devoting to consumption, that MPC. And this MPC can take a value between 0 to 1. Now, suppose my MPC is suppose 0.8. That means 80% of change in income is now devoted to consumption. If the MPC is suppose 0.2, then only 20% of the increased income is being spared for consumption. So higher MPC is basically possible in a country with maximum concentration of poor people. In case of poor people and low income category people, the MPC is very high. They spend more on consumption. But as income increases, at a very high income level, the MPC is basically low, because the additional increase in income, out of the additional increase in income, very less proportion of income is being devoted or earmarked for consumption. Therefore, the MPC declines. MPC declines. Therefore, taking this, this is my consumption function, Y equal to CA plus CY. Now, given this, how to find out the equilibrium in the real sector or goods market? Equilibrium in the goods market. Now see how equilibrium is possible. I don't have time to take example on each part. Therefore, I will come to the most important part. There is the integration of the two markets. Now, having said that, how to find out the equilibrium? Now see, for equilibrium, what is necessary? In a macro-theoretic sense, macroeconomic sense, equilibrium required AD equal to AS. Like in the microeconomics, we have seen demand is equal to supply is the point where the market price is decided, or the market reaches equilibrium when the demand is equal to supply. Similarly, in the macro-theoretic sense, aggregate demand becomes equal to aggregate supply, and at that point, the market clears or the market reaches equilibrium. Now, we'll see how in the goods market or in the real sector, this AD equal to AS equilibrium is reached. Now, see. Now, aggregate supply and aggregate demand. How to make a distinction here? See, aggregate supply means whatever amount of money you have, whatever amount of income you have, what you will do with that income? This total income, either you consume or you save. This is from supply side. How much income I have? So whatever income I have as a person, I can either consume that amount of income, or if there is surplus, that amount I will save. So total availability or total supply of income Y is a combination of consumption plus saving, Y equals C plus S. Now, if I take Y here, if I take this income, we know through the income analysis, national income equal to expenditure equal to output. So If I take income here, then this income is a combination of consumption plus saving. So I can take C and S here, consumption plus saving. So in that case, what happens? If my income is rupees 100, then suppose 80 rupees I am consuming, then only 20 rupees I am saving. In the last class, I have already told, because saving is that part of income which is not consumed. Or we can write, if Y equal to C plus S, then I can also write Y minus C equal to S. So S, saving, is that part of income which is not consumed, minus C. So therefore, if 100 rupees is there, then this is 80 plus 20. That means this 100 is equal to this 100. Therefore, I can take as a 45 degree line, where I can write aggregate supply is equal to C plus S. Or it is, we can write Y equal to C plus S. That means 50% this, 50% this. That means whatever income you show, this 100 is equal to this 100. Same thing. So equal proportion. So this is my line. This is also called the 45 degree guideline, because this will indicate your supply status. Then what about this aggregate demand? This aggregate demand in a two-sector model, in a simple two-sector economy, where there is only farm and the household sector, we say the aggregate demand is done for consumption by the household and investment by the farm. We have already done in the last class. So AD is equal to C plus I. That means aggregate demand is equal to consumption demand, or demand for consumption plus demand for investment, C plus I. We have to make a division between these two. Now, this aggregate demand, consumption demand, investment demand, in the basic class, in the basic Keynes model, what he has done to judge the impact of consumption on the equilibrium level or the relationship between consumption and income, he has taken the investment as fixed, as given. Investment taken as given. Now see, we have already drawn the consumption function. This is the consumption function C, because this is the autonomous part, autonomous consumption, and the rest part is dependent on income. Investment is given and fixed. Now suppose if this is my fixed investment, I, then what this total will show me? This much of consumption plus this much of investment, C plus I. So this is my C plus I. This C plus I equal to AD. This C plus I equal to AD. And here this is my C plus S equal to AS, aggregate supply. That means in the basic Keynesian model, basic Keynes model, simple Keynes model, in the goods market, given the investment, this is the point where aggregate demand is equal to aggregate supply. And this is a equilibrium level of income. At this point, you can find this is AS, this is your AD, C plus I. Now, if it is a two-sector economy, in case you take it as a whole economy or the four-sector economy, in the book you'll find four-sector economy, then C plus I plus G. G means government investment, government expenditure. You take the government sector into consideration. That is the three sector. Plus X minus M, export minus import, you know that. That means the foreign sector is included now. So if you add those factors, then this curve will shift and shift, because we'll take those as given. Now, in the goods market, the equilibrium is possible at this point. Now suppose I take this as E. At this point, now aggregate demand equal aggregate supply. If we extend the analysis to the saving part, suppose I take saving and investment here separately, because saving and investment are the two most important constituents of the goods market or the real sector. Now see, if I extend my analysis to this, then we'll find now this is my saving function. This is my saving function. Where my saving function? Now see this point. Suppose I am taking this point at B. B means break even. At this break B point, you see, this is my consumption and this is my saving line, consumption and income line. That means at this point, I have income is equal to consumption. Income, just as much as income, as much consumption. So therefore, it is a zero saving. Anything to the left, you see, this is consumption, this is income. Consumption is more than income. You are consuming more and earning less. It is saving or negative saving. Anything to the right of this, your consumption is more, your income is more than consumption. They are earning more, consuming, spending less. This is positive saving. Therefore, this is saving function. Now, since investment is fixed given here, we can draw the saving investment function like this. This is my investment function. Now, this is the point of equilibrium. Ye you can write, Ye you can write. So, at this point, where aggregate demand is equal to aggregate supply, at that point, saving is equal to investment. Now, here also we can do that. That means in the Keynesian system, in the basic Keynesian model, the goods market equilibrium is reached. I repeat, the goods market equilibrium is reached at that point at which the aggregate demand is equal to aggregate supply. And with respect to that AD and AS point, or with respect to that equilibrium point, the saving is equal to investment. Now, I can also write in a different way. Now see, for equilibrium, we require AD is equal to AS. Aggregate demand must be equal to aggregate supply. Now, what is my AD? AD equal to C plus I, consumption demand plus investment demand. Now, this is equal to what is my AS? Consumption. I can either spend on consumption or spend my income on saving, C plus S. Now, this implies I can do like this, C plus I. I can take this C to this side. Then this will become S. I took this C to this side, become minus. Now this implies plus C minus C gone. So now investment equal to saving. So when AD is equal to AS, we also get the situation where investment is also equal to saving. So this is the situation of goods market equilibrium. In the Keynesian sense, goods market equilibrium is achieved when AD equal to AS and also investment is equal to saving. The most important or the more interesting part of the story is that when we do this, when we are doing the Keynesian equilibrium like this, this is my AS, this is C, and this is my C plus I, this is AD, and this is my equilibrium point. Now this is income we are determining. Why each we are doing? This is the actual income level, equilibrium income level. This is your equilibrium consumption level. Now this, see this. This is C plus I you have taken. Now the question is, when we are talking about this equilibrium level, we are determining income. What about the price? Where is the price? We are not talking about the price here. Because you assume that, what do you assume that? The price is given. Why the price is given? I have already told you in the Keynesian system, the price is fixed because the aggregate supply curve is like this. This is my aggregate supply curve, so price is known. That means while doing this, you must keep in mind that price is not a part of the story. Price is taken as given. It is fixed at this level. One thing. Second important thing that you must remember. What about the interest rate? We don't have the interest rate given here. We are just talking about aggregate demand, aggregate supply, consumption, investment, and income level. We are not taking about the rate of interest. That means in the Keynesian system, when we are talking about the equilibrium income level, why? We have also assumed that the rate of interest is given. Price is given, rate of interest is given. Now see, what does it mean? The rate of interest is determined in the money market. I have already told you in the last class, the rate of interest is decided at that point where the aggregate demand for money is equal to aggregate demand for aggregate supply of money. That means where demand for money is equal to supply of money, rate of interest is decided. So rate of interest is the price from the money market. Now here, while determining the equilibrium in the goods market, the real sector, Keynes has assumed that the money sector's equilibrium is given, rate of interest is given. So R is not a part of the story. That means in the goods market or in the real sector, H decided, determined by Keynes, income level is decided. Where we can decide? Where we have decided, but rate of interest is constant. I'm drawing a line above this. Where is decided? R is constant. That means we know the why, in the goods market R is constant. That means here also again, the goods market has been analyzed independently of the money market. But here I am not using the concept classical dichotomy because this is, I am talking about Keynes. So in the Keynes scheme of things also, or in the basic Keynesian model, the real sector equilibrium or the goods market equilibrium has been developed in isolation by assuming that the money market equilibrium is given. So again, there is a separate treatment of the goods market and the money market. So you must remember that here, the goods market equilibrium is determining income level taking R as constant. R is constant. Now, for equilibrium, what will take him? Now, see, in the goods market, consumption is what? Consumption is a function of income level. Why? That means when we are taking AD equal to C plus I, you must try to understand this. The aggregate demand equal to C plus I. Now, this C is a function of Y. What about I? Investment. Investment is a function of, always a function of rate of interest. Investment depends on rate of interest, you know that. Higher the rate of interest, less the investment, because the people keep money in saving form. Low the rate of interest, people go for more and more investment because of the MEC kind of thing. That we'll discuss later on. Now see, one thing you must remember, consumption is a function of income level. It is a direct function. Investment is a function of rate of interest, it's an indirect function, negative function. R increases, I fall. R fall, R increases. But when we talk about aggregate demand or why, this aggregate demand Y is equal to C plus I. I am writing this implies this Y, this aggregate demand is equal to consumption, which is a function of income level, and investment, which is a function of rate of interest. So this AD, this aggregate demand is a function of two factors. See, I take this as equation number one. See, this my aggregate demand is a function of two factors now, Y and R, income level, rate of interest. Now mathematically, we have one equation, but there are two unknown variables. We neither know Y nor R. When there is one equation and two unknown variables, then unique solution is not possible. I repeat, when there is one equation with one unknown, unique solution possible. Two equations, two unknown variables, possible unique solution. But here we'll find one equation is there, but there are two unknown variables, Y and R. That means unique solution is not possible. What does it mean? It means goods market equilibrium in isolation cannot be achieved unless and until we have a reference to or link to the money market equilibrium, because R comes from the money market. That means it is an incomplete equilibrium. If you discuss the goods market in isolation without linking it to the money market, then there is no unique solution. Only we are deciding why. In the simple Keynesian model, in the goods market, we are only deciding why by taking R as constant. So it is an incomplete equilibrium. So you must understand this much, that in the goods market equilibrium by Keynes, Y is decided, R is remain constant. One thing. Now we'll move to the money market. In the last class, we discussed thoroughly about the money market equilibrium in the Keynesian theory. I told you about three types of demand for money. We discussed that in the money market. In the money market, demand for money, suppose I am writing demand for money, or you can write MD also, you can write MD, demand for money equal to MS, supply of money. Demand for money is equal to supply of money. Like any other market, equilibrium is possible in the money market when demand for money is equal to supply of money. I told you in the last class that the supply of money, MS, is equal to a constant. Why it is a constant? Because the money supply is decided by the Reserve Bank or the central bank of a country. Because it is decided exogenously, since it is a part of the policy decision of an independent body like the RBI, at a particular point of time, we take this as a constant, because again, it is a stock variable. I have already orally told you in the last class. It is a stock variable. So at a point of time, this is taken as a constant. So therefore, money supply is given. Then what about this MD, demand for money? In the last class, I told you that in the Keynes theory, demand for money consists of three different types of demand. Transaction demand for money, precautionary demand for money, and speculative demand for money. In the last class, I told you that the transactions demand for money, that means how much money we are going to transact, how much money we are going to spend in the market, depends on income level. Higher the income level, higher the transaction demand. Low the income level, low the transaction demand. Similarly, the precautionary demand for money is also a function of the income level. That means how much money we are keeping to fight against future uncertainties. As a part of our precautionary measures, it depends on income level. You have a high income level, then you can keep a part of that your income as your precautionary demand for money. Therefore, since the precautionary demand for money is not that significant in our analysis, what we have done in the last class, we keep the transaction demand and the precautionary demand as part of one demand for money, and that is L1 I took. You must remember in the last class, L1. L1 means transaction demand for money and precautionary demand for money. It depends on income level. Why? But that is not the end of the story. I told you about the third important demand for money. There is about the speculative demand for money. The speculative demand for money, I related that with your interest rate and bond price in the last class, if you remember. The speculative demand for money is a function of rate of interest. It is an inverse function. The speculative demand for money is a function of rate of interest. Higher the rate of interest, less the speculative balance. That means if the rate of interest is high, people will keep less money. Liquidity preference will be low. If the rate of interest is low, people try to keep more cash in hand. Liquidity preference will be high. So it is inverse function. It's an inverse function. Now you see, if this is my equilibrium, suppose I take this as equation number two, the first one I have taken one. Now we will find demand for money is a function of Y and R. Again, income level and rate of interest. That means one equation, two unknown again. In the last part also we saw in case of goods market, the aggregate demand is a combination of income oriented part and interest oriented part. Y and R, there also we found one equation is two unknown. Here in the money market equilibrium also we are finding the same situation where equation is one, but there are two unknown variables Y and R. Now the question is, this is not a unique solution mathematically. Now, if I show you the graphically, what you did in the last class, if you remember, this is the rate of interest we take in the y-axis. This is money, demand for money and supply of money. As I told in the last class, the supply of money is given, MS, it is fixed, it's a vertical straight line because the RBI decides how much money to supply in the market. So the money supply function is given. What do? We derive the demand for money function, and the demand for money MD function starts from here, because this gap is what? This is the transaction demand for money. This is fixed with respect to a particular income level. The income level is given here. So where the income is there? Nowhere. This axis MD, MS, this axis R, no income. In the goods market, this axis income, the other axis C plus I, no R. So in the goods market equilibrium, you won't find R, it is taken as given. When it comes to money market equilibrium, we will find R, Y is given. Nowhere you can find Y, because this Y is taken as fixed. With respect to a particular income level, the transaction demand L1 is fixed up to this point. Then the rest part is precautionary demand. Therefore, the total demand for money is equal to this plus this. This much of transaction demand plus the rest is precautionary demand. Now, this is the point where there is equilibrium. Demand for money equal to supply of money. So this is my equilibrium rate of interest, RE. That means in the money market, the equilibrium rate of interest is decided at that point where demand for money is equal to supply of money. And this is what I have already told in the last class. This is the liquidity trap. This is the horizontal straight line part. Perfect elastic part. Now this is R0. R0 means the liquidity trap region. Liquidity trap. This is the minimum interest rate. Minimum interest rate below which it is not expected to go down or fall. You cannot equate the interest rate to be zero. This is the very minimum interest rate. At this rate, this elasticity is perfectly elastic. That means even if you increase the money supply, there will be no impact on the interest rate. But this is a trap, like the I told you in the last class, the mouse trap. Whether you move the curve to this side or to the this side, the MS line, it will have the same arrow. So this is the liquidity trap region. Now what I want to say here is that when we talk about the money market equilibrium in the Keynes theory, we decide the R, but Y is not there. Y is assumed. We decide the R, Y is assumed. That means if you treat the real sector or and the monetary sector, the goods market and the money market separately, as done by the classical dichotomy people, if we separately determine the goods market and the money market, we will find the solution is not unique. We won't reach to a equilibrium position in macro-theoretic sense. Because in the goods market, Y is decided, R is not known. In the money market, R is decided, Y is not known. Now the question is, in a macro-theoretic sense, if we talk about my whole body, can you keep my heart in equilibrium without having any association with my head? Can you keep my kidney in a good, well-functioning mode? Can you have my kidney doing its work properly without having my nervous system or maybe my heart pumping or maybe my head? No way. One part or one system of my body is working properly because it is working in congruence with other parts of the body. It is linked with other parts of the body. So when you talk about the macro part of an analysis, the aggregative part of an analysis, you have to adopt the structure. You have to adopt the system approach. That means you have to see the entire gamut of things in a single canvas. You have to determine each and every part of the system simultaneously. That is what has happened in the Keynesian theory. If you determine independently, in one market, goods market, only Y is known, R is not known. In the money market, R is known, Y is not known. But you see, there is a close link between the rate of interest and income level. Income level and rate of interest are clearly linked. That linkage now will establish in terms of the Keynesian logic, the post-Keynesian logic of the integration of the two markets. Since in one market, Y is known, other market R is known, and both the Y and R are intricately related. Both the goods market and the money market are related in a system sense, in a structural sense. You have to take both the systems simultaneously. You have to take the integrated whole of the both goods market and the money market equilibrium. Because in that case, what happens, if I show it mathematically, then you can find in the goods market, what it did? Aggregate demand. Now this is equal to what? C, function of income, plus I, function of rate of interest. This is my first equation. This is goods market. I am writing GM here, goods market. When I come to money market, the same demand for money, like demand for goods here. The demand for money is a combination of L1Y, L1 was precautionary and transaction demand for money, function of income level, plus speculative demand for money, L2, function of rate of interest, equation 2. Now see, the first equation I have got from what? Money, goods market, where Y is decided, R is fixed, given. Demand for money I have got from the money market, where Y is given, R is decided. So in the first equation, Y is known, R is not known. In the second equation, R is known, but Y is not known. Now, if we mix these two, if you integrate the goods market and the money market, if you don't believe at all on the classical dichotomy or an isolation kind of an approach, in that case you have to integrate the two. Now what will happen if you integrate the two? You see how many equations I have now. I've got two equations now. How many unknown variables I have got? Two unknown variables, y and r. So two equations and two unknown variables. That means a unique solution is possible now. Number of equations must be equal to number of variables, unknown variables to be determined. Now, if you separate the two markets, then solution is not, doesn't exist. If we integrate the two market, we'll find two equations having two unknown variables. So unique solution is possible. Now the next question is how to integrate. The people, the economists who followed Keynes, they took a different approach. They synthesized both good markets, goods market and money market. They believed that they analyzed the thing. They propounded that unless and until we have an integrated approach, unless and until we integrate the goods market and the money market within the gamut of a system as a part of a structural approach, we cannot determine the macroeconomic equilibrium. The equilibrium position in macro sense cannot be determined. Therefore, this is called a synthesization of the classical and the Keynesian theory, or you can say synthesization of the goods market and the money market equilibrium. And this is called the ISLM analysis. This synthesization results in something called the IS and LM analysis. Now, IS means investment and saving. Where from we get the investment and saving? From the goods market. L and M. L means liquidity, M means money. That means supply of money, liquidity, and this is demand for money, M. So supply of money and demand for money. So this is from the money market, LM we get, and this is IS we get from the goods market. When you integrate with those two, we'll get the IS and LM curve approach. And we'll see, with the help of the IS and LM curve approach, we decide put Y and R simultaneously in one place. In the earlier diagrams, we could not find that. In the first diagram, only Y we decided, R was not there. In the money market equilibrium, R decided, Y was not there. But in the IS LM equation, in the synthesization of the real and good sector equilibrium, we'll find both Y and R being determined simultaneously within one system, whereby we can say that the entire economy is equilibrium because goods market and money market, both the markets are in equilibrium. So we'll now move to the IS and LM curve analysis. Now in the IS and LM curve analysis, first we'll find out the derivation of the IS curve. Investment and saving curve. How we derive the IS curve? Now it is a four cell diagram. I'm just drawing the diagram so that it will understand it better way. It is a four cell diagram. It is not that difficult to understand. In the four cell diagram, we take the first one as A, this take this as A, this is your B, this is your C, and this is your D. Anti-clockwise, A, B, C, D. Now, you don't have to mug up things. You can understand very well how we are taking all the four diagrams. Because in the fourth diagram, D part, we'll derive the IS curve. In the first diagram, we talk about investment and saving. We'll take investment on the x-axis and rate of interest on the y-axis. It is because I have already told you, investment and rate of interest are inversely related. And you understand that. Higher the interest rate, less is investment because more is going for saving. Lower rate of interest, more investment. Therefore, the investment rate of interest relation is in the first part. And I will explain why we are taking this. Investment, rate of interest. Now, if this horizontal axis of the fourth diagram, this first diagram, sorry. If the horizontal axis of the first diagram represents what? Investment. Then the one above that will also represent investment. Now this is my investment again. If this is I, this is also I. If this is my I, then I will take investment equal to saving here, the equilibrium. The equilibrium, investment is equal to saving. We'll see this, how this saving and investment are related. Now, if I take this as, if this is my saving, then this curve will also, this axis will be saving, this is my saving. If this is S, this is S. Now this saving is a function of home. Saving is a function of income. Saving is a function of income because we have C, C plus S, Y equal to C plus S. Then that amount of income which is not consumed is saving. So I take Y here. Now if this axis is Y, then this axis is Y. I take Y here again. Now if the first diagram, if this axis is R, then this axis is R. Now the interesting situation, you see the diagram number D, this one, fourth D. This is the axis. It is either Y, this is R. That means in one diagram, you can decide both Y as well as R. But in case of goods market, only Y you get, there is no R. In the money market independently, only R you get, no Y. But when you integrate both the goods and money market, you will find both Y and R. You will find both Y and R in the same diagram, in the same space. Now see, how this R and I are interacted, their relationship is inverse relationship. So it is an inverse function. Then saving and investment, how saving investment moves? Saving is equal to investment means, suppose it is a upward line like this. That means at the standard level, saving is equal to investment. So both are at an equilibrium point, saving equal to investment. Now saving is a function of income. So this, it is upward sloping curve from this. Why this is from this? Because this is the de-saving part. I showed in the first part of the diagram, goods market. Because after an initial level of income, saving starts. There is no saving at zero income. There is consumption at zero income because without eating, people will die. But saving starts only after a comfortable level of income is achieved. So therefore, the saving function won't start from this zero or from this. It will start from the income axis. So this is from Y. So this is my saving equal to investment, income relationship. Now, if I start a relationship here like this. Now see, this is my investment, this is my R. With respect to this, see, this is my saving, this is my income. With respect to this, this is my income. And this income is possible at this rate of interest. This is R decided. So one point I'm getting here. If the ratio is like this, this is suppose R2 and I2, then see how it will move. All these diagrams are given in your book. Just you have to understand why I'm doing like this. Now see. Now this is the point I'm getting, Y and R. If I join these points, see, this is my S curve, investment equal to saving. Because here I have investment, here I have saving, here I have saving, here I have income. But I have also given the R here. I have not taken the R as constant because this R now might depends on investment level. So while talking about saving and investment from the goods market, from the goods sector, AD equal to S, I'm also taking care of the rate of interest. Therefore, the money market and goods market are integrated here. And through this integration, what I have got? I have got an IS curve, investment saving curve, which represents the goods market equilibrium, and it is a downward sloping curve. And this downward sloping IS curve represents both interest rate as well as income level. Why? So at the same plane, we are deciding both Y and R. This is the goods market equilibrium. Now move to the money market one. We'll find the solution very interesting, and also we can complete within our time limit. Now see, in the money market case, that is LM curve. How we derive the LM curve from the monetary sector. Now if you draw the diagram, it's the same four cell diagram. In the same way, we can take the LM curve also. In the first diagram, we'll take speculative demand for money. This is ABCD again, anti-clockwise, A, B, C, and D. In the D part only, we will derive the LM curve. LM means demand for money, supply of money. Now here we will take speculative MSP. I am taking MSP. I have already taken. That is speculative demand for money. Speculative demand for money. We are talking about the money market. Therefore, speculative demand for money is a function of what? Rate of interest. We have seen that it is a downward sloping curve or the indirect function of the rate of interest. Now, once this is MSP, this will be also MSP. The above curve will also MSP. Then, how the MSP is related to MT? MT means transaction demand for money. Because whatever total demand for money is there, one part is called L1. That I told you, there is transaction demand for money depends on income level. The rest part is speculative demand for money, L2. Now, if this is my transaction demand for money, so this will be my transaction demand for money, MT. This is my transaction demand for money depends on what? Income level. We have already seen transaction demand depends on income level. Now, if this is Y, then this lower part will also be Y. This will be Y. Then if this is R, this will be R. Now see diagram number 4, Y and R. Again, we are determining the income and the rate of interest at one plane, at one place. This is through integration in terms of the LM curve. Now we know how the MSP and R are related, speculative demand for money, rate of interest. This is a downward sloping curve. MSP, this is the trap region, liquidity trap. Now this is my MSP curve. Then MSP and MT, transaction demand for money and speculative demand for money. The curve is like this. Why like this? Because if the transaction demand for money is full, then MSP is zero. If you are utilizing the entire money for transaction purposes, for spending, expenditure, then no money is available for speculative demand for money to invest in bonds and securities. Similarly, if you spend the entire money, invest the entire money in speculative demand for money, then you are left with nothing, zero transaction balance. Therefore, the curve is like this. Then the transaction demand for money and the income level we have already seen, upward sloping, because high the income, high the transaction balance. Low the income, low the transaction balance. Now from this, we can easily now derive our curve. Now see. From this, I get this Y. And this is my R. This is the point I'm getting. If this is my point of reference, then see. I'm getting this point. See, this is my point. Now, from this, we can, by joining this point, we can find out the LM curve. Now, this part, it is a vertical straight line part, perfectly elastic in this sense, representing the minimum rate of interest, the liquidity trap. This is the trap region. This is the minimum rate of interest. This is the R0, because you cannot expect this to go down. So this is the R0. So from this elastic part, it will again upward sloping. This is my LM curve. Now this LM curve derived from the money market equilibrium is again representing relationship between Y and R. This Y we get from the goods market. This R we get from the money market. So again, this is an integration. Now see, by taking this IS curve and the LM curve into consideration in the Keynesian sense, now, how to apply this to the equilibrium that Keynes has already told in the basic model? Now, the synthesization, or it is called the multi-market equilibrium. Sometimes we get question like multi-market equilibrium. It is also called the general equilibrium approach, not partial equilibrium. Partial equilibrium approach means we are just talking about either the goods market or the money market. In partial sense, only goods market talks about income determination. Only money market talks about determination of interest rate. That is called a partial equilibrium approach, like we do in case of microeconomics. But in macroeconomics, we need to expand our analysis to the whole gamut of things in an economy. Therefore, it is a general equilibrium approach they have to adopt. In the general equilibrium approach, all the markets, they are in equilibrium, they are interconnected like all the systems in my body. Therefore, it is also called multi-market equilibrium or general equilibrium approach in a macro-theoretic sense. Now, the general equilibrium approach, I can get the equilibrium position by taking R here and Y here. In the earlier analysis, we were either getting Y or getting R. There is either and or kind of things. If we talk about the goods market, only Y you get. Talks about the money market, only R you get. But once you take the IS and LM curve analysis into consideration through synthesization. Now see, this is my LM curve. Now this is the point where you get the equilibrium Y and the equilibrium R. And this point of equilibrium represents the general equilibrium where we integrate the real sector as well as the monetary sector. So the synthesization or the integration of the real sector and the monetary sector by the Keynesians, the people who followed Keynes, is dependent on an integrated approach determining both Y as well as the R. Now see, from this integration, what benefit we get? Now from this, we derive the aggregate demand curve. How we derive the aggregate demand curve? Now see, if we take a diagram like this, this is Y, so this is my Y. Then this is aggregate demand. Now, what do you take price level again? Like we did in case of classical and Keynes. This is the price level. This is my demand supply. Now the actual equilibrium in the market, see, this is the point. This is my eddy curve. This is the eddy curve that I am deriving from the equilibrium point. That means the market, the multi-market equilibrium, through integration of the goods market and money market, we determine the aggregate demand curve in the Keynesian theory. Now, if there is a shift in the aggregate, suppose IS curve, for example, there are changes in the goods market. The IS curve shifting outward either because of increase in investment or decrease in investment or whatever. So because of the increase change in the investment scenario in the market, if the IS curve is shifting, then see, this is my new point of equilibrium Y1. Suppose with respect to this, we have a different AD curve. Suppose this is AD1. Similarly, suppose there is shift in the LM curve because of changes in the demand for money in the money market. Then in that case, if the demand for money or supply of money also changes the LM curve. Now then the LM curve will shift. This part is shifting, this is the elastic part. Then the LM curve will shift like this. If both IS and LM curve shift, then this is the new point of equilibrium. I'll get another AD curve. This is AD2. Now we'll reach to the point where we started with. What I said in the Keynes theory. In the Keynes theory, the aggregate supply curve, if you remember properly, I had told at the beginning, the aggregate supply curve in case of classical vertical straight line. In case of Keynes, it is horizontal straight line up to the full employment level. So in the Keynesian theory, my aggregate supply curve is like this. Therefore, price was fixed, price was known. What we have to decide? We had to decide the output level. Now see, this is my aggregate supply in the Keynes theory. And suppose this is my full employment output. Suppose this is my YF. This is suppose my aggregate supply curve. Now in the Keynesian theory, this is the aggregate supply curve, which is a horizontal straight line up to the full employment level. Then it becomes a vertical straight line. Why it is a vertical straight line? Because we have already reached the full employment level. There is no possibility or potentiality on the part of the economy to extend further. Now see, given this aggregate supply curve, in the Keynesian theory, we have derived the aggregate demand curve from the integration of the goods and money market from the entire system. This aggregate demand curve intersects the aggregate supply curve at this point. Now the question is, the intersection of the aggregate demand and aggregate supply is not determining the price, because the price is already given in the Keynesian system. What do we decide in the Keynesian system? Aggregate output we decide. This is Y1. That means, as I told in the beginning, in the classical theory, output is known, price was unknown. Output was known, price was not known. In the Keynes theory, just opposite happened. Price was known up to this level, but output was known because Keynes held the view that output never reaches the full employment level. All the economies operate below the full employment level. So at what point the output is decided? It decided by what? Aggregate demand curve. See this. Now this is the output decided now. So through the integration of the aggregate demand, the integration of the goods market and the money market, real sector and the monetary sector, now the aggregate demand curve so derived determines the aggregate output given the price level. Now you see, if this is my aggregate output Y1, then I'm sure you will find that this Y1 is far less than the YF. That means the economy is operating below the full employment level. This is the full employment level. But the aggregate, the equilibrium output in the economy is Y1, given the price. This is called the underemployment equilibrium. This is the underemployment equilibrium, which was not there in the classical theory. Classical people said there is full employment equilibrium. All the economy operate here. But Keynes proved that there is underemployment equilibrium. The economy is at this point. Then what he said? Any improvement in the output level, any increase in the output level from Y1 to Y2, the increase in output level depends on what? Not aggregate supply. It depends on aggregate demand C, because aggregate supply is given. Only an increase in aggregate demand can lead to an increase in output level. That means economic growth or economic development possible only when there is shift in the aggregate demand curve. I repeat, in the Keynesian sense, any increase in aggregate output or the economic growth or economic development is possible only when there is the shift in the aggregate demand curve from AD1 to AD2 or AD to AD1. That means economic growth or economic development depends on what? Demand, aggregate demand. That's why it is called, the Keynesian theory is also called the demand side theory. And during the Great Depression of 1929, this solution Keynes gave to the classicals, to the economists. Keynes said, unless and until you increase the aggregate demand in the economy, you cannot take the economy out of the shackles of depression. If you want the economy to move off, if you want the economy to take it out of the difficulties of depression, or if you want to revive the economy, then that is possible only through demand management. See here, and this aggregate demand depends on what? This increase in aggregate demand is possible only through interaction of both money and real sector. So intervention is needed both at the monetary sector and in the goods sector. Now further, what Keynes said, if economic growth or development is possible only through shift in the aggregate demand like this, AD1, AD2, AD3, then who will be responsible for shifting in aggregate demand? Now he said, demand management requires intervention of the government. The government has to intervene through various fiscal policy measures. There came the fiscal policy. The classicals are basically talking about monetary policy because they are supply side economics. Now Keynes said, increase in demand only take the economy to increase in income level. And this increase in income level or increase in aggregate demand is necessary or is required the intervention of the government. The government has to intervene. So the laissez-faire policy prescription of the classicals. The classicals are talking about what? Free market economy. Laissez-faire. No government intervention. Zero tolerance to government intervention. Leave everything to the market. The market demand and supply will decide everything. Keynes take an opposite view. Keynes said, if you leave everything to the market, then it will lead to too much inequality. Too much inequality. And the sales law of market saying that supply creates its own demand not going to work, because in the process of supply, sales has said what? In the process of supply more and more goods and services, the necessary demand is generated in the market, necessary purchasing power generated in the market, and all supply gets its appropriate demand. therefore market clears. But there are leakages. There are leakages. What Ken said, supply is not going to create such demand automatically. Unless and until there is demand, supply is meaningless. Supply is not going to clear. Therefore, there is need for demand management. Demand creates its own supply. Now, how we improve the demand? Demand management required increasing purchasing power of the people. And those people who are at a very low level of income, if the economy is rotting at the depression level, then you cannot expect the economy or the business class or the entrepreneurs to come up on their own. Because the economy is second, it is at a very depression level, very low level of trap. So unless and until there is government intervention, you cannot take the economy up. You cannot increase the aggregate demand. Now, how the government intervene? Ken suggested government intervention is possible through fiscal policy measures. And fiscal policy measures, government intervention requires a macro-theoretic approach. They have started the public finance kind of thing, public finance, public economics. The government has to intervene in the market. Laissez-faire is not going to solve the problem. Government intervention is necessary. Government will intervene, invest hugely in the market through fiscal policy or budget policy operations. And that's a government spending lead to an increase in aggregate income via what? Multiplier. You know what a multiplier is. Multiplier means change in income due to change in investment. Because of the MPC, high spending in the market, if you spend money or if you invest money, then the resulting output will be 3 or 4 or 5 multiples of the original investment. That is called the multiplier. So therefore, more and more spending will revive the economy through multiplier effect. That is what the Keynesian prescription was. Therefore, disaggregate demand, shifting in aggregate demand, will lead the economy out of repression. And this is depend on the multi-market analysis. That means, what you understood from this is that money market alone is not going to solve the problem. You cannot do everything through the fiscal policy operations of the government. We need to have a co-integration of the two. We need to synthesize both. We need demand management as well as supply side, supply chain management. We need to have both the goods market equilibrium and also the money market equilibrium. You cannot keep one market in isolation of another. Therefore, there is need for a general equilibrium approach to economic growth. Therefore, the synthesization of the goods market and money market is necessary, and this is what the Keynesians have done. It's the synthesization of the goods market and money market. Therefore, this is a general equilibrium approach. So if we talk about the equilibrium in the Keynesian sense, then the equilibrium will be like this. Now the aggregate supply curve is given. It is a vertical straight line, horizontal straight line up to the full employment level. This is Y here. This is my aggregate supply curve. And this is my aggregate demand curve. This is AD. Suppose AD1 I'm writing. Price is given. This is the price level fixed. This is the output level. Suppose Y1. Any shift in the either AS curve or LM curve or both, if the aggregate demand curve shifts further to Y2, AD2, then the income level increases from Y1 to Y2. Any further increase Y1 to AD3, further it will increase in income level. That means this is the full capacity of the economy given full employment output YX. Any movement towards full employment will lead to development. Or development entails movement from a lower level of output to a higher level of output as close as possible to the full employment level. It's not possible to reach the full employment level for any economy at any point of time. But development requires movement from a low level of output to a higher level of output as close as possible towards the full employment level. And this is possible only when there is shift in the aggregate demand curve from AD1 to AD2 to AD3 to AD4. And this shift in aggregate demand curve, given the price level P, it depends on the goods market equilibrium and money market equilibrium determined through the ISLM curve analysis. Therefore, economic development or economic growth depends on a general equilibrium approach of intervention, a general equilibrium approach solution, where government intervention is necessary, and I need to take care both the monetary policy as well as the fiscal policy. The fiscal policy, effectiveness of fiscal policy, effectiveness of monetary policy, there is a different discussion altogether. Again, that depends on the elasticity of the aggregate demand, IS curve, LM curve. There is a different thing, but in this particular chapter, in the block, this much you understand that Keynesian theory or the Keynesian economics is called the demand side economics because of this. It is the aggregate demand which is determining the output level. And through this only we can take the economy from the low level equilibrium trap or to a depression level to a higher level. This is what he suggested in his book, The General Theory, 1936. And that was just against what the classical prescription was. Therefore, this is called the Keynesian revolution. That's why it is called the Keynes is called the father of modern economics. And this prescription is still going on. You cannot keep the Keynesian logic outside the purview, whether you are a capitalistic economy or a socialistic economy or a mixed economy. You need to go for demand management. It is necessary. So with this, I close the session. If you have any question, then you can ask.
Thank you so much, sir, for an elaborate discussion on the modern theory of economics, that is about the Keynesian theory, initiating from the fundamental psychological law of consumption through the aggregate demand, aggregate supply part, and from the equilibrium in the money market, money demand and money supply, the synthesis of ISLM curve, and about how the derivation is made about of the IS and the LM curve. It was a quite fruitful discussion about how it is a demand side concept of having a general equilibrium model. It was quite clear, and I hope the learners are understanding it well. So I may I request all the learners to ask their question if they have any in the chat box. Sir, if I may ask.
Yes.
Sir, what are the, since LM curve is the money market equilibrium and we have least control over it, what are the various components that shifts the IS curve? What are the what mechanism works in the shifting of the IS curve?
Now, IS curve represents the goods market. When you talk about the goods market, the most important components in the goods market are the saving and investment. And I have already thrown lights on that. Now, saving and when we talk about saving and investment, IS curve is more elastic, or IS curve is more sensitive to changes in investment. Now, having said that, changes in investment depends on what? Changes in investment depends on rate of interest. So, what kind of a interest structure you are having in the economy, that decides the IS curve. Now, see, if the rate of interest is very high, suppose take a situation where the rate of interest is very high. In that case, we'll find the rate of investment to be low, because we know that high interest rate crowd outs investment, public investment. High interest rate structure is generally anti-growth. Anti-growth generally believed as anti-growth. That means if the interest rate is very high, then you have the low investment. Then in that case, we'll have a downward shifting LM, IS curve. A downward shifting IS curve leads to a leftward shift in the aggregate demand curve. This aggregate demand curve that I have drawn here. If the IS curve shift leftward, then in that case, if I draw the IS curve like this, if the IS curve goes down, then in that case, the aggregate demand curve will be shifting leftward. It is a low growth syndrome. It is a low growth kind of a situation. Therefore, the IS curve, again, depends on rate of interest. Similarly, if you are having a low interest rate structure, other factors are also there. There are a lot of other factors, like what type of market you are operating with, situations in your capital market, then your public policy making, then the international scenario. A lot of factors are influencing this interest rate and also the investment climate in an economy. Therefore, mostly the interest rate determines the level of the IS, the investment schedule, and the level of the investment schedule influences the IS curve. And this shift in the IS curve again leads to shift in the aggregate demand. You can also talk about the MEC, marginal efficiency of capital, but because of the scarcity of time, I didn't venture into that area. But Students can read that in their book, whichever blog it is in. How the marginal efficiency of capital is basically related with the interest rate, and the relationship between interest rate and the investment is basically through the MEC, marginal efficiency of capital. Therefore, rate of interest is the most important factor which determines the shape and position of the IS curve. The shape and position of the IS curve again determines the equilibrium in the whole market. The whole market, whether the interest rate is high, if the interest rate is high, then obviously your income level will be low because investment is coming down. Like the way I showed you, if this is your curve, if this is your IS curve, then what you are taking? We are taking R and the Y here. Now, if the rate of interest is high, you will find low income is low. Once the rate of interest is low, the income is high. That means you want to, if they increase your income level, you want to have a high income scenario in an economy like India, then it is possible only when you have a low interest rate. But again, you cannot go beyond the minimum interest rate. There is a liquidity trap. A very, very minimum level of interest is neither desirable, and a very high interest rate is also not feasible for economic growth. Therefore, interest rate structure of an economy is a very important factor. And therefore, the government is also taking all very seriously. The RBI is managing the interest rate in a very, 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 very intensive manner. You will find the management of the repo rates, reverse repo rate, the liquidity adjustment facility being taken up by the RBI, and the quarterly review that the RBI is doing in recent years. So therefore, the rate of interest is a very important factor, or the interest rate structure of an economy is very important, as long as the demand management policy of the economy is concerned.
Thank you so much, sir, for this discussion. And it is quite helpful for us to understand. And I hope that the learners will understand also, because further it leads to the public economics. The entire concept of public economics revolves around this IS and LM curve made with the allocation function or the distribution function of the government. But they would read about the monetary intervention and the fiscal intervention of the government and the RBI. And this is quite an important block that we have covered today. And this being the final class, thank you so much, sir. And
Thank you so much.
For sparing your time and enlightening our learners about the macroeconomics concept that are quite necessary for them to understand. And I'm also thankful to the learner for their patient cooperation that they have given throughout this process of online teaching. I mean, online classes and the sessions that we are having. And we would also like to thank all other faculties who are not from economics but have joined out of their own interest in the class in all these sessions. And even today, there are many. And thank you so much, sir. It is your lively interaction.
Thank you. I enjoyed interacting with you all the learners, the support staff, the counselors, and your consultants, technical support team, everyone. So I'm thankful to all of you. I think I have done justice to you within the limits of time and resources. So thank you very much. In case you face any difficulty, you can ask me anything outside this classroom arrangement. No issue. So thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Nishant?